success was and what people were promised to make the sale. But you have complete control over the level of optimism that is attributed to the timelines and the resources needed. So if you say, if you know, based on your experience, that something takes 40 hours if it's a good scenario and 80 hours if it's a bad scenario, never, ever, ever estimate the time based on a feeling of fantastic optimism. So if you're feeling at your sunniest in the morning after your jog and you've had your coffee or your smoothie, never estimate the timeline for anything at that point. Because you're going to think, ah, oh, this is a piece of cake. Wait till it's a rainy day, you haven't had lunch, you're tired, you have a headache, your feet hurt, and then figure out what it looks like at that point, and you're probably going to be much more realistic. Because over-optimism is one of the number one hurdles in having projects go from fun to not so fun. Your other problems, which you have less control over, are competing priorities, team expectations, and corgis. Now, I will explain about the corgis later on. But competing priorities are one of the things that make a lot of project managers dread project management, because you've suddenly gone from being the person responsible for the copy or for the user experience, for the wireframes or for the information architecture, to being responsible for all of the different pieces, as well as higher level strategic responsibilities, like, is this website going to generate leads? Is it going to be under budget? Is it going to be on budget? Is it going to be on time? And some of these priorities definitely compete. So having the copy being absolutely perfect and nailed down is going to compete with your timelines. You know, having the graphics be high quality is going to compete with budgets. And when you're only responsible for the graphics, you can care less about the budgets. Or, for instance, balancing the amount of copy versus the amount of imagery on the site. There could be one person on the project who thinks it should be image heavy, another person on the project who thinks it should be text heavy, and you have to mediate between the two. And if you can't be firm and you can't stay in control of deciding between those competing priorities, that's another thing that becomes a hurdle. You start to tell everybody what they want to hear, even if you're not doing it consciously. And suddenly everyone thinks that they're the top priority, and not everything can be the top priority. So slicing through the competing priorities and deciding what really is important is something that many of us, if we are working as individual contributors, don't have as a skill set, but that has to become our skill set when we become a project manager. And it's very hard for us because it involves completely different character traits, not just skill sets. You really have to learn to be able to say no to people in ways that maybe if you're an introvert, you're not used to doing. Then there's what I call euphemistically team expectations. When I say expectations, I don't just mean what the different members of the team that you're managing expect out of their work in terms of, is there going to be coffee in the coffee machine, but I mean different levels of work ethic, different levels of thinking of things as priorities, different ways of communicating, different attitudes. You're really talking about personalities here. And then what do I mean by corgis? Okay, so I first started talking about project management in relationship to corgis when I first gave a talk on project management. It was at a Drupal event, and I had intended to get to that event at about 9 o'clock in the morning and have a chance to look at the other sessions. Then I go out, I run a couple of errands, it was a Saturday morning, and when I come back, I'm driving down my street, and there is a corgi with no collar on walking down the road. Being a humanitarian kind of person, I realized, well, I can't just leave this poor dog in the middle of the road, he'll get run over. I have a big old Volvo station wagon, so I pull over by the side of the road and I say, hey, Corgi, here, I just, well, I didn't know his name, it turned out that might be Ralphie. So I say, hey, come on, I'll put him in my car, I'll drive him to the police station, and I'll leave him with the animal control officer. Problem one. Corgis are too short to climb into Volvo station wagons. He tried. It was actually kind of adorable with his short little legs. He kept trying to hop into my car. It didn't work. So now I was stuck. I had to leave my car in the road, walk the leashless, collarless dog down to my house, and put him in my garage. Then I called the animal control officer. No answer. I called the main phone number for the police. and they say the control officer is on vacation. Could I please mind the corgi for a few hours, and they will let me know if somebody called looking for Mr. Corgi. So from one simple problem, I find a corgi in the road. I have an escalating domino series of problems, some inherent to the nature of corgis and Volvo station wagons, some contingencies that could have happened completely differently if it had happened on a different day, like people being on vacation. And so when you're talking about, oh, my plan is to get there by this early time, one tiny wrench in the works can have a spiraling series of negative effects on a project. And you never know where it's going to lead you. So I ended up being 3 hours late, babysitting a dog, until finally the grateful owner showed up and took him home. So this is what I mean by a corgi. That one little seemingly harmless, apparently quite cute thing that pops up in the middle of your day and causes an admittedly adorable catastrophe that leads to more. So those are your hurdles, but you can beat all of those hurdles. So when you talk about project management, it's really about hurdle jumping. If every project flowed smoothly, there would be no need for project management as a profession. Everyone would just come together and it would be like an ideal of like a primordial hunter-gatherer society that needs no authority, needs no organization. Everyone just knows their role. They hunt, they gather, they pick the berries, they take down the bison, and it all just works beautifully and self-organizes. Real life doesn't work like that, and that's where project management comes into place, because of the hurdles. The reason we form societies is because there are predators, bad weather, disease, famine. That's why we form societies, and that's why we have project managers. If you think of it that way, you are basically the first cave person coming out of your cave who's decided we need wheels. That's who you are. And how did the first cave person decide that we need wheels? Well, he anticipated. He didn't just react. So it's really, really hard, because when you are an individual contributor, your job, it's much less anticipatory than it is reactive. Someone tells you to write copy, you write copy. Someone tells you you need imagery that's suitable for a website for dentists, you do that. You don't necessarily just do as you're told, but you're given specific and very concrete assignments, and you do that, and it's satisfying, and that's your day. You have to anticipate things in terms of, okay, the copy is going to have to be X amount to fill X amount of space, but you don't have to think about what happens if a corgi runs amok in my office. You don't have to think about what if the budget gets cut, but they still want most of the original website. You don't have to think of 50,000 contingencies in a day. And so the transition from individual contributor to project manager is a transition from being largely reactive to largely anticipatory. You're essentially being asked to become a professional worrier. And I didn't say warrior, I said you're going to be a worrier. So how do you take down the big problem of over-optimism? Well, you take the time you think anything will take, and like I said, don't do it on an optimistic day, and then triple it. Seriously. Mentally triple it. Even if you think that, you know, maybe it will only take double the optimistic estimate, always pad in plenty of time for things when you're estimating out a project or planning it. That way, you prevent panic. You prevent panic within your team, you prevent panic with you, but most importantly, 90% of project management is managing the expectations of others. You're making sure that people feel happy about things are going, how things are going. Because if you tell someone it'll be done by tomorrow and it doesn't happen, you have failed. If you tell someone it'll be done by the end of the week and it happens day after tomorrow, you've succeeded. So you have to really bear that in mind. And again, I can't emphasize this enough. The essence of project management is not about the tactics, it's about personality. It's about the way that you use your personality strengths, and sometimes you have to change how you express your personality. A lot of the times, if you're coming from a design or a copy, or regardless of your background, if you're used to being the doer of stuff, the hardest thing is to go out and be the assertive face of the team. and be willing to say no to people over and over and over again for their own good. It's really almost a parental role. So when people want to hear that something will be done day after tomorrow, I mean, hands up how many times clients have had unrealistic expectations of timelines. Has anyone not had that happen to them? Right? Never. You have to, however, develop the strength and presence of mind to say to them, it's not going to work out like that. It's going to take X amount of time. We often, when we think we're being over-optimistic, it's really more like shyness. You don't want to be the bad guy. You don't want to be the person who says it's going to take tons and tons of time. Unfortunately, when you start being a project manager, you have to be the bad guy more often than not, and this is uncomfortable for a lot of people. You really have to get to a point when you are willing to make the uncomfortable decisions and say the uncomfortable things. And so when we go back to why do we dread project management, it's not because we hate Trello, it's not because we hate Excel, it's not because we don't like to talk to people. It's because project management involves taking responsibility for uncomfortable conversations. So how do we do that? Well, we go back to the competing priorities. So when you're faced with a bunch of competing priorities, even when you're an individual contributor, you often find yourself having to decide, okay, I can focus on making this copy really, really zingy, or I can focus on getting it done on time. And then maybe if you tend to write really long sentences, it's not going to be as concise as it would be if you had had three times as much time. But when you're managing a project, you have to deal with competing priorities from dozens of other directions, as we were talking. So what you have to do is you have to learn to prioritize, evaluate what's really, really going to help meet the goal, and then you have to focus a lot of your time and energy on building consensus. Project management is emotional work. It's not about using tools. It is partially about using tools like Trello and Asana. But if you think about project management as tool usage, you're going to fail. So we talked about being the first caveman to use this or that tool. That's great. Tool usage is really good. But project management is 99% emotional work. And it is okay to say to yourself, I don't like emotional work, I don't want to do emotional work, and I don't care for it. There are plenty of really good jobs out there, still as an individual contributor, and many, many people have said, listen, I had a management role, and I went back to being an individual contributor because it suited my personality. It is better to be honest with yourself and say, I hate emotional work, than it is to push yourself into project management because it is 90% emotional work. However, you can, like me, learn to enjoy that emotional work because at the end of the day, it can be very rewarding helping other people do their jobs better. And the first way you're going to do this is you have to learn to be very good at building consensus. Some of the worst project managers I've seen are the ones who don't build consensus but who think that leadership is sort of dictatorial. We're going to do it this way. Hands up how many people have been on projects where somebody was just like, this is going to be like. Hands up people who were happy on those projects. Hands up how many people have worked with somebody who has gone to you, regardless of what your role was on the team, and asked you, how would the best way to do this be? The client is asking for us to do this much more quickly than I know is necessary or ideal for this project. What do you think you can trim? That little room of quality, what can I do to help you get your job done within the time that we have to be? How many times have you been treated that way? Yeah.
Normally,
just say, like, do it. How would you be happy if someone came to you and actually asked for your input in that way? So if you work with your team and you ask for their input and you say, hey, look, this is the goal we have to meet. I understand that this is going to be tough. How are we going to do this? You're going to have much more buy-in from your team. And at the end of the day, you are not omniscient. You don't know all of the different things that are going on in the different parts of the project. If you're good at one thing, you're not necessarily good at the other. You're going to have a better insight into how the project's going to get done if you do ask for your team's input and you do build consensus. and that is team members as well. So the number one thing when you're facing competing priorities is you have to build consensus both within your team and with your clients as to what's the best way to do this. This is what we want to do. These are the resources we have to do them. This is not adding up, because it almost never does add up 100%. How are we going to meet this goal? It's a very tough, soft skill to develop. But if you develop this soft skill, 99% of the friction that develops on teams can be at least mitigated. As you said, it's soft, it's low. However, there are also going to be times when you have to just decide and be the person who says, listen, I know this isn't ideal, we're just going to push this live, it's just, it's 90% good. But you have to develop a balance between building consensus and making decisions. So this is where the fact that project management is mostly emotional work becomes, I think, the most challenging for a lot of people, which is what I call, like I said, team expectations. So in other words, people who maybe have different senses of what the cadence of work should be. There's always, hands up everybody who's worked on a team with somebody who had very high need for appreciation. And so that becomes another expectation. There's ways of keeping people happy on teams, though, and they're really, really critical. One is to communicate a lot. I think for a lot of people that's a challenge. I think we've all worked on that project where we weren't entirely sure what was going on, because nobody seemed to tell anybody anything except on a need-to-know basis. Don't ever let that happen to your team. Even if you're not a really talkative person, make sure you communicate as much as possible with people why everything's happening. Don't ever have stuff be on like a need-to-know basis with people. Make sure most people know most of what is going on. Don't be like, well, I'm gonna tell the developers this tiny thing that they need to know. I'm gonna tell the designer this tiny thing they need to know. I'm gonna tell the copywriter this tiny thing they need to know. No one's gonna have the full picture of the project except me, because then I am all powerful and I get to talk less anyway. It's not helpful. You wanna over-communicate. If you're dealing with things where people are either unsure about what their goals are for their project, or maybe they're not hitting them, to put it nicely, it's really important to set benchmarks and have frequent check-ins. So in other words, if there's like an expectation that this is a reasonable amount of work to get done in a day or a week, you want to make sure you communicate those benchmarks to people. And you want to check in with people well before they're going to fail to accomplish that, and see how they're tracking towards that goal, and figuring out, are they going to accomplish that goal with maybe a little bit more support? Maybe you've swamped them, maybe they're punching way above their weight, and they do need a little bit more support or some more training. But rather than setting people up to fail by not hitting benchmarks and then coming back and telling them you didn't meet expectations, but you never communicated the expectations, make sure you create distinct benchmarks and then check in with people to make sure that they're hitting them. And then make sure that you also do things to just build people's morale. In other words, there's really nothing wrong. I mean, please, for the love of all things, don't just throw a foosball table into your office and call it a day. How many people get up in the morning and think, you know what the bright part of my day is going to be? I'm going to play some foosball! And if anyone thinks that way, they need to get a life. That's not how you build morale. You build morale by showing appreciation and giving people control to the extent that you can. You build morale by acknowledging their contributions, by allowing them to learn. That's how you build morale. You can have them play foosball if that makes them happy, but to be perfectly honest, most office foosball tables eventually end up covered in wilted potted plants and empty beer bottles. So think about authentic, genuine ways to build morale, and you'll find that your projects work better. Again, I know some of you probably came into this session expecting this to be about how do I set things up in Trello, and how do I move the little cards around, and what's the optimal way to put stuff up into Trello. If that's how you manage a project, your team members are going to hate you and your teams are going to fail. You can use whatever tools you want, and we are going to talk talk about favorite tools, but this is what project management, you know, in terms of making it fun, is about. It's about making sure that your human relationships are working. It's also making sure that you can recover from the attack of a corgi. So again, corgis are the random one tiny thing that turns into 50 giant things and causes you to be almost late in your own session. Totally random things always happen, and they often happen at the last minute. They just do. They just have a magical way of turning up just when you thought, that was working well. Hey, we're going to be on time. We're going to be ahead of time. We're going to be under budget. This is going to be fantastic. We're going to win awards. Oh, shoot. That is a very frequent thing that happens. And so when you build your team's morale, when they feel honored, respected, appreciated, when they feel that they have a voice, you're going to be amazed at how fast you can recover from corgis. Because if someone is constantly told, just do it, when a problem arises for which they have a solution, they won't dare speak up. Because they're so used to being told, just do it, that when you say, oh my gosh, this is a disaster, okay, this is completely breaking in IE1, and almost all of the site's users are in IE1, or whatever weird, bizarre problem has happened, hey, you would be surprised how many early versions of IE you end up having to have it working. The person with that solution, if they have gotten ground down, and let's face it, there are a lot of teams where the entire team is really ground down, where they're used to being told, just get it done, I don't care, where they're never rewarded, never acknowledged, never encouraged to share how is the best way for things to get done, where they're just told, just do it. They may have tons of creative solutions, and they won't be able to think of them. Creativity is severely impeded as well, not just mental health and physical health, by being given very little choice. And so when times are good, maintaining the morale of your team, when stuff gets bad, and it always inevitably will get at least a little challenging, they will rise to the occasion, they'll be willing to stay late, and their minds will be in a frame where they're capable of what is called divergent thought, which is thinking creatively and thinking in different directions. You have to be in a good frame of mind, you have to feel safe, you have to feel positive to be capable of divergent thought. When people are under stress, parts of their brain shut down that are used for creativity, and they become tunnel visioned. So if your team is chronically stressed by feeling like the people on that floor of the retirement community that they have no choice in life, they're going to have tunnel vision when problems come up. Now, on a tactical level, some of the other things that help you overcome corgis in the road are those padding in for extra amounts of time, as well as planning for all of the contingencies that can't possibly be anticipated. So now let's get to the nitty-gritty. So we've talked about team a little bit and how to keep them informed. So when you start managing a project, you need to be able to manage your team, but you also need to work on technology and time. So you need to be able to take all of the resources, like how many team members do we have, what is our budget, where are we going to be getting images from, do we have a budget for getting images, or are we stuck with iStock photo or something. You need to take all of those things, and you are going to need to use technology to manage some of those things. So you do need to find a project management tool that works for you. But you also have to bear in mind is that no matter what tool you use, you're going to encounter a fair number of people who aren't going to be comfortable using it, regardless of what you use. Whether you use something super simple like Trello, or whether you're using Basecamp, you also have to be willing to train. If you spend the rest of your time looking for that one perfect project management tool that's so intuitive, nobody ever has to be trained on it, you're never going to find it. So find a tool that can work for you, we're going to go through some of that, and then be willing to train a few people, whether they're on your client side or whether they're on your team side, who don't know how to use it. And then you have to be really, really mindful of time. You have to be good at delegating things. You have to be good at managing scope And you have to be good at the philosophy that done is better than perfect. So let's talk about these two things. Delegate-wise, I think we've all got a firm grip on. You need to be able to know who you can handle things, hand things off to, who can handle it. And you don't necessarily, you shouldn't think in terms of job title. So maybe somebody is your lead UX designer, but when you're assigning different aspects of a project, they may not be the best person to handle a really critical part of the UX design, because maybe there's a junior person on that team who's worked on those kinds of projects more. So think about, get to know your team members and know their specific skill sets, and don't just delegate down through the chain of command, but start to think about, okay, so, you know, this lead designer is good, but their skills in responsive design are actually not as good as Bill's. Like, Bill's just been on the team for a year and he's only got 3 years of experience. But if the site is going to be primarily mobile for users, like 80% is going to be mobile, maybe you're going to give more responsibility on this project to Bill because he really, really kicks ass at mobile. Don't necessarily just assign it to the person who is most obviously there in the org chart to take the most responsible role. Give it to the person who's going to get it done the best with the least amount of friction, the least number of errors. So really make sure when you delegate, you think about the perfect person for each role. And if you don't have that person, don't be afraid to hire subcontractors or to train people. But really make sure the right people are doing the right things. Now, managing scope. Almost nobody, when they first start to manage projects, doesn't allow scope creep to happen. So do not get eaten up by shame. I'm thinking of like starting a scope creep Victims Anonymous group. You're never ever, even your first 2 or 3 projects, you're never not going to have scope creep happen to you, because you're so excited to be given all of this stuff to do that you'll just start saying yes to a lot of things. And more things. And hopefully, if you were really, really good at time frames and estimating the time, you overestimated the amount of time for simple tasks enough by using my rule of thumb to triple things, that there's room for some of that scope creep. Now, whether you're not going to lose money with the scope creep, I can't be responsible for that. But if you allow it to happen the fifth time you manage a project, it's all your fault. It really is. It's scope creep. You may get really mad at clients because they push extra stuff on you, but if scope creep keeps happening to you, it is all your fault. It goes back to that issue of when you stop being an individual contributor and you start managing projects, you have to put on your Viking helmet, get your cat and nine tails out, and don't be afraid to say no to things. And putting on that Viking helmet is probably the hardest part of transitioning into being a project manager. But that is what managing scope is about. If every client had limitless money and a limitless sense of how much time they want the site to be done in, scope creep would not be a problem. It would be called more work. Scope creep is only a problem because of the competing priorities of time and money on one hand and client desire on the other. And you have to be the one who mediates that. And it always involves having tough conversations. So when you manage scope, you're actually managing people. The other part of managing scope is to have the sense that done is better than perfect. And this is actually, the slides were not deliberate, but I actually typed that type when I thought I'm going to leave it in, because it was 7 o'clock on Friday night and I built these slides. So I thought, what a better example of done is better than perfect than that slide. Now, that doesn't mean that the site shouldn't degrade nicely. It doesn't mean that there should be typos on the home page. It means that there are a lot of things in every project that are nice to haves. And often there's people on the client team who are really vociferous and demanding, you know, wouldn't it be nice if we had custom hand-drawn illustrations on every single page? Well, if you can find clip art that fits with the style of the 3 custom hand-drawn illustrations that their budget actually allowed for, or you can just crop out bits of those illustrations and put them on the other pages, that's done, and it's a heck of a lot better than your vision of perfect. because their vision of perfect would have led to scope creep. So the easiest way to cut off scope creep is to have a sense of what kinds of imperfection you can tolerate and your client can tolerate, and deliberately go after that kind of imperfection. The hardest thing is that we often end up with accidental imperfection. It's 7 o'clock on a Friday night, and we have to finish our slides before we miss the last train, and so we end up with an extra letter C imperfect. If I had planned for imperfection, I would have said, you know what, I don't need all these custom squiggly brackets, and I don't need to do all of these fancy graphics, I'm just going to put text on a page, I'm done, and I would have been done at 5 o'clock. So when you start planning for imperfection, you get much closer to done without scope creep. Decide what can be cut out, and again, go to your client, go to your team, and decide what kind of imperfection are we going to accept. And again, it's really difficult emotional work, because you're asking people to pull back from their vision of perfect and go back into the real world, which, as we all know, when people start on a web project, has nothing to do with what they actually want. Reality has nothing to do with what they actually want. So project management tools. When you're picking project management tools, you need something you and your team and your client will actually use, because nothing is sadder than an empty base camp file. Like, nothing is worse than that. Factor in different things like the cost, and if something's in use, use it, even if it's not optimal. So if you're working with a client and they like to organize everything with Gantt charts and you would sooner poke your eye out, but they're willing to update a Gantt chart, but every time you try to get them to use something elegant and nice like Asana, it's empty, and then they don't give you feedback in time, you're far better off using the Gantt chart. Just go for it. Just do it. Also, take into account people's cognitive style and technical skills. So if the people that you think are not going to go into a project management tool, who aren't going to work in it, are really visual learners, then use something really visual like Trello. If they're numbers-oriented people, like maybe you're building a site and the CEO is really hands-on, and he's a Gantt chart person, and he's a numbers person and an Excel guy, give them something like one of the great Gantt chart tools out there, because his cognitive style is going to find that a very low friction way of working, and he's going to go in there and he's going to do it. He's going to actually approve things, he's going to check things off as done, and it's much better for people to actually use the tool and give feedback than it is for you to go to your vision of what the perfect tool is. So I think we're all pretty used to Basecamp. Hands up. Everyone who's used Asana or has heard of it. So a couple people have not heard of Asana. It's a really simple, intuitive. It's got some social chatter features so that you can incorporate comments the way you can in Basecamp. And you can see the different comments people have seen in one stream. You can see what's assigned to you in another. So I really like that. Casual is, it's super visual. So it's almost as if someone were drawing on a board. And I really like that if you're dealing with are highly visual in the way that they communicate, because it's extremely simple and it's got more of like a visual. I'm going to put this on a board here and pin it here and pin it there. It's easy for them to see the pieces, but it's a little less verbal. Trello is super easy for people who are using mobile devices, and it's really good for things that have a lot of moving pieces that are time sensitive. You create different boards with to-do, in process, and done, and it's just dragging from one to the other. There's not a lot of social chatter incorporated. However, I'm using a tool now called Slack. The attention was actually drawn to it by a coworker at Impact Hub, and it integrates with Trello and Asana, so you can add an almost sort of Jabber or Facebook-like functionality where you can see conversations about what the project is and about the different aspects of the project, and you can integrate it with Trello, and it's drag and drop, here's a file, here's the next assignment. The number one challenge with all of these tools is honestly getting people who've had something assigned to them to check off that they've done it. Or give feedback, and getting people to actually regularly check in. So I found that when you use Slack, because it pushes into people's email accounts, just like Basecamp, it's going to be, well, all of these can be configured to push into people's Basecamp accounts, but with Slack, I've found that it gives people real-time notifications as well, and they have the app open, so it's really, really handy for getting people to pay attention. Hey, you gotta respond to this. Now, when you're dealing with remote teams, and we're almost at time, so I'm gonna speed this up a little bit, it's really important. I think the number one thing that people have issues with as a project manager when they're managing a remote team is the 3 a.m. phone calls. That's the part that's the hardest, really, is that people are in different time zones, and that leads to a lot of challenges for them. The manager, because you're the one that's beyond all those 3 a.m. phone calls. So really be locked down in your use of collaboration tools to minimize those calls, and don't be heroic about it. You don't necessarily have to be on the phone at 3 a.m. Things can be taken care of asynchronously using collaboration tools. And don't be afraid to ask people to meet you halfway and talk to you at a time that's semi-reasonable for you. There's very few places in the world where you can't talk to someone at 7 a.m. or 7 p.m. Eastern time and have a reasonable conversation with them, and it's not the middle of the night there. So don't try to be a hero. Talk to people at 1 p.m. their time, because that's when it's comfortable for them. If they're not your client, both of you might have to be a little bit off hours, and it's better if you do that and you both work a little bit off hours than you try to be on hours for somebody else. People burn out that way more than anything else. And more importantly, other than just sort of cutting out the burnout, build a sense of camaraderie with your own team. Make sure that you're not all just people checking in different pieces of the project, but have Google Hangouts and have Skype calls, because again, project management is mostly emotional work. And so I'm going to summarize that part in one last slide. I think the number one thing that people say when they dread project management is that they don't think that they can do it. You have spent most of your career as an individual contributor, you spent most of your career as a geek, and now you're the boss. And that really challenges your self-confidence, and it challenges your self-identity, and sometimes it challenges your communication style if you're very introverted. So if you find that project management is hard for you and you've used all of the tools and you've used a bunch of tactics, the problem might be, in a good way, you. And I say it's in a good way because you can address that. Do you have a hard time calling yourself the boss? Do you have a hard time putting on the Viking helmet? Do you have a hard time dealing with crises and saying, all right, listen, everybody, calm down, we're going to do this? And do you have a hard time, on the other hand, high-fiving other people and stepping back from being the person who did this stuff and being now the cheerleader, congratulating other people for having done this stuff? Because those are going to be your real roles moving forward. So if you want to make project management fun, make sure that you use the right tools. Make sure you're really good about preventing scope creep. Make sure you're good at estimating timelines. But also make sure that you realize that what you're doing is incredibly valuable, and that your new identity as the person cheering on the people who do the stuff, helping them do it better, and making sure that resources are allocated well and that clients are communicated with well, is every bit as valid an identity as I'm a graphic designer, I'm a developer, I'm a copywriter. It challenges your identity because it seems so nebulous. I'm managing a project. How is that an identity versus I'm a developer being an identity? But it's your identity now. And if you're going to be successful as a project manager, that is probably going to be, on many days, your number one hurdle. Is embracing the identity that I don't do stuff anymore. I manage the people who do the stuff. But because I manage them well, I make them happy at work, I make the clients happy, stuff gets done to epic proportions. And if you can embrace that about yourself, you will find that even on days when packs of corgis are biting your ankles, project management is actually going to be fairly fun. With that, I think it's time for me to open it up to a couple of questions. Yeah.
What about if you're the only person?
If you're the only person.
And you are managing yourself and your client. You're doing the design, or you're subbing out the design, and you're doing the building.
And you can manage yourself.
Huh?
And you have to manage yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think the number one thing is, going to be very hard for you, but easier for somebody else if you can afford to do that. Be really, really good at checking in every single day with the project management tool. Like when it's just me, I like to use Trello. You can't be on top of all the moving pieces enough when you're working alone, because it's just so easy to let something slip through the cracks when it's just you. You have to be crazy organized. Use like a board. Like don't get a cork board for your wall and physically pin up things that you need to deal with. That often helps a lot. I mean, it seems like really old fashioned. But sticky notes, reminders on your phone. Don't be afraid to assign things to yourself with a tool like Slack and then ping your phone. That really helps. And also, my biggest advice is also give yourself time to rest, because it can be really, really intense when it's just you. And budget in the time for you to, if you were someone's employee, you would take a lunch break. You would probably check Facebook a couple of times a day. You know, you would go for a walk or go to the gym in the evening. Make sure you allow yourself that, because we're usually harder on ourselves than anybody else's. Yes?
I noticed in the tools we didn't have a Microsoft project. I worked on CDF projects that involved those cross organizations. And I'm using Microsoft projects there.
Yes! That's why it's not in the tools!
So is it something that you use before and you decided it's not valuable?
It's valuable. I mean, like I said, use what's in place. If people are using Microsoft Project, use that. Don't try to force any tools on an organization, because that's a battle that's very hard to win. But you hit the nail on the head. Nobody looks there but you. The bigger, more heavy duty, like something like Microsoft Project, the more likely people aren't going to check in and use it. If you can at all avoid using Microsoft, I mean, I don't want to bash that tool in particular. But the reason I picked those tools is there. I found after testing out a lot that those are the ones where you can get a lot of buy-in, because they're either very commonplace or they're free, or they're really simple for people to use. So, I mean, if you have to use it, but yeah, that's why I didn't. There's Joan in the back.
Do you have any tips or strategies for emotional communication for remote teams?
Yeah.
How does it feel that, you know, like where's that balance at? How do you communicate?
Over-communicate a lot when you're dealing with a remote team, because it's just so easy for an email to be misunderstood. Especially if you're dealing with people across cultures, it's the possibilities for emotional communication to go wrong are bigger. I would even strongly recommend having meetings with people if you feel like you don't understand the communication style. Have get-to-know-you meetings via Skype or Google Hangout that aren't even about the work or are barely about the work, and budget an hour, budget 45 minutes to talk to them about their past experience. Interview them as if for a job interview, even if you've just inherited that team, and get to know them. And if you can do it via video, it's the best, or even via audio, because you can sense, like, some people have a really sarcastic sense of humor like I do, but once you've talked to me on the phone, you understand that I'm sarcastic. And so when I send you a sarcastic email, sometimes, once in a while, someone will send me an email saying, "Is this sarcasm?" And I'm like, "Yeah," because they know to expect that, because they've heard my voice. So if, on the other hand, you're only communicating with them via email, they may take that kind of thing seriously. Also, American English is so idiomatic that it's so easy to miscommunicate, because 90% of what we say is metaphorical, or could be inflected metaphorically. And just honestly, you could end up saying like things that people will take literally that they shouldn't. But if you talk to them, it would be.